Hey, I'm Brother Taylor Lindemann, pastor at First Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Mississippi. We're so glad you joined us online today for this sermon. You can find additional sermons at these online sources. I hope that the sermon today speaks to you, and we pray that God will move through it.
If you will, open your Bibles with me to the Epistle of James as we finish out today the third chapter. Today we're in James chapter 3, and we're going to be looking at verses 13 through 18 in a sermon entitled, The Wise Man's Conversation. My sister, she's still involved in dance even today, and I tell you, for two older brothers, there wasn't nothing worse in the world than going to a dance competition or a dance recital or a dance anything. I don't know if there's any wise man in here who would say amen to that one in front of their wife, but my mama ain't here right now, and I can say, that was tough. I mean, these dance recitals would start on Friday night at 5 o'clock, and they would do solos all Friday. And then Saturday, you came up there at 10 o'clock, and they had a part one and a part two performance. And it ended sometime Saturday at like 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. I mean, it was a two-day event. It was ridiculous. And for two older siblings to be sitting there at their sister's dance recital for that long, you know we got into some trouble. My dad wisened up the third or fourth year, and he started taking us to the balcony of the Temple Theater in Meridian because he knew that we were going to get into some trouble. We would try to drop popcorn off the balcony into people's laps. I mean, we would do it all. But when we got tired of that type of mischief, we would begin to sit down. You see her up there on that stage? Look it. Did you see her? Oh, she about fell. We would start talking about the folks on stage. And my mama always, she'd pinch me, she'd pop me real good. She said, you don't talk about anybody up there on that stage. And it was not the reasoning that it's wrong, anything like that. It was a wise answer. She said, because the people whose family member that is might be sitting right in front of you or right behind you. And how would you feel if you were talking about their little girl and their family was sitting right in front of you? And well, the guy in front of me, he was kind of scary looking. And so I decided, Mama's got some wise advice. And so today, as we look in James chapter 3 at these last few verses, God is going to give us, through James' epistle, some wise advice. And he's going to distinguish this wisdom into two different categories. There's the worldly wisdom that we all know is so prevalent in today's age. And then there's that wisdom from God. Would you stand with me in the honor of reading God's word as we look at James chapter 3, beginning in verse 13. Hear now the words of the living and true God. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have any bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable and gentle and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Would you bow with me once more for prayer? Father God, we thank you for your word. And Lord, as we seek wisdom in this hour, we ask that it would be the godly type, that you would help us to discern that which is evil and that which is from up above, and that you would show us in the innermost parts of ourself the wisdom that dwells inside of us, that we might rightly understand the conversation and the conduct of our lives and whether or not it aligns with yours. Lord, we pray that you would be with us in this hour, that you would show us our sins, and that you would set us free from its bondage. Lord, we pray that you'd be here dwelling amongst your people in this hour. It's in your holy and precious name, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. How do you tell a wise, an intellectual person? You know, many people think that it is by the knowledge that can spew out of one's mouth that you can tell a wise person. Certainly in today's day and age, there are lots of markers of wisdom. I met a person one time, and it was like he gloried in using big words that you couldn't figure out what they meant. I would talk to him, and we would get to about, you know, the third, fourth sentence in our conversation, and he would say one of those words that you cannot go on any further in the conversation unless you say, pause, let me get up and get out my dictionary and look this word up so that I can actually understand. Well, you don't carry the Oxford Dictionary around with you, and so you've got to ask him. And as soon as you ask him, well, what does that word mean? What do you mean by that? He stands up a little straighter. That smile grows real big because suddenly I'm better than you. Suddenly, I know more big words than you. And that person, he'll give you that definition for that real smart word just for two or three sentences later for you to have to stop him one more time. So soon, you start avoiding people like that. But the world around us thinks that these are the type of people who have worldly wisdom. These are the people who are knowledgeable, who are our academic best. And many of us have met a person very similar to this one. And while the world may think that this proves a wise and knowledgeable man, Scripture tells us this is not necessarily the marker. Verse 13 of James 3rd chapter tells us this: who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? It's the same question I just asked. It's the same question our world asks. And this is James' answer: let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. How does James tell us to show our wisdom? Through good conversation. Now, I hope you brought your own copy of God's Word with you today. And if you have anything probably besides the King James Version, the word conversation is not there. And while sometimes that is a red flag for us and worries us, this time when the King James has something different, it is a translator's decision here. And it's a very interesting one. I want to first look at why the King James has this here, and then we can go into what that means beyond the surface there in the Greek. Because James' context, if you remember, for all of chapter 3, we've walked step by step, verse by verse through it. Chapter 3, if I had one word I could describe it by, it would be tongue. Chapter 3 is all about the tongue. It starts with the preacher's tongue and the power of it and how offensive it can be sometimes. It goes on to everybody ought to watch the words that come out of their mouth. It continues on, and last 2 weeks ago we talked about it, that this tongue can be a fountain of blessings or a fountain of cursings. And now James finishes out, and he uses this term in the King James, conversation. How is wisdom shown? What does it mean to have good conversation? James doesn't mean to be somebody that's easy to talk to. No, good conversation for James is in the sense of what he's just finished talking about in those preceding verses. And if you're going to exercise biblical wisdom, then you have to say those things which are categorically good. Your conversation must be devoid of filthiness, of profanity, of vulgarity. It must be instead a conversation that honors God and others. If we have godly wisdom from the Lord, it will be evident in our good conversation. And so, seeing the difference in the translations, this term conversation, it actually goes a little bit deeper. I agree with the King James translation that it shows the context of all the preceding verses. It touches the very point of contact which James wants to make. But this term conversation goes much further than that. This word translated conversation is the Greek word anastrophe. It's not used very often, but this word is the word that James has chosen because it means exactly what he wants to say over the previous two chapters. That word anastrophe means behavior or conduct. It's one way in which we conduct ourselves is through conversation, but this word really means an upturn or a conduct that finds its roots in what we truly believe. James couldn't have found a better term to encapsulate what he's been saying since he said faith without works is dead. That he's saying this is conduct that presupposes you have faith. It's walking the walk if you're going to talk the talk. It's all of these things in this one verse. To have good conversation here means that to be a truly wise man is not by great knowledge. It's not just by what you know or what you believe. It's about what you do. It's about what you say. It's by how you live. True wisdom is found in the one who lives out what he believes. And I have to stop there and I have to ask myself as a Christian, and you have to ask yourself as a Christian, do I live out what I truly believe? Do I live out my life like I'm serving a God who raised up from the dead and conquered death and hell and sin? Do I live that way? Am I a wise man living out what I truly believe? Am I a man who lives out my life knowing that my God is watching every second? Am I a person, a Christian, who lives like Jesus is one day coming soon yet again? That's what we believe, isn't it? Do we, anastrophe, in good conversation, live, talk, breathe, and act as if those convictions are true in our life? That's the mark of wisdom. That's the mark of maturity. That's the mark of true faith. That's what we've been searching for since chapter 2. Is how can I know, Brother Taylor, that I'm a Christian, that I've been changed? Because your life in the Holy Spirit will begin to model that. It is the good conversation that James shows us. And James continues in verse 13 to show us that the primary characteristic of this wise person, this wise work, is humility. Verse 13 says this, let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. Meekness, or out of the humbleness of his wisdom. The man who brags about his knowledge. The man who relishes in being right when others are wrong. The one who seeks the applause of others more so than the glory of the God he serves. That is not a wise man. That is a worldly man. A wise man serves in humility. And if we want to look and we want to say, well, how do I know this is true? Let's look at the life of Jesus. Let's look at the one who embodies wisdom itself. Jesus, though he was Messiah, though he was coming to accomplish the prophecies that were told of him, how did he come and how did he live? He did not live as a king riding in on the white horse to conquer his enemies. He did not live as one who wanted the applause of the Pharisees and of the traditions around him. He didn't live as one who wanted to come in and live high and mightier than everyone else. He was a king who came as a servant. He was a king who spent his life serving others and providing them nourishment at the feeding of the 5,000. In casting out the demons they'd lived their lives conquered by. In doing more miracles and showing humility among every step. It was on the night that he was about to die. What did he do? He was washing the feet of his disciples. This is the embodiment of wisdom. It's unthinkable to say Jesus was not wise. The people marveled at his teachings precisely because it was. Humility and wisdom cannot be separated. They grow one another together. But at the same time, if I asked you, what one characteristic of the Christian faith would you like? Well, I've talked to some of you before. I've talked to Brother Ricky before, and we hesitate to pray for patience, right? Because we say, whoa, the Lord will teach it to you. But how many of us, if we said we want, what characteristic of the Christian faith would we want? I think most of us, we'd say joy. I want the joy that surpasses understanding, the peace that surpasses understanding. I want, name it. The last thing that comes to your mind is probably wisdom. I think it's because this word is so unused in our daily talk today in society. I think it's because we don't value knowledge, especially spiritual knowledge, as much as generations past. But I think what James is showing us here is that the biblical characteristic that we ought to yearn for, and this characteristic is exactly what Paul pointed out in our study that we looked at over a year ago in 1 Corinthians chapters 1 through 4, is wisdom. Because without wisdom, we can't do any of the things that God has commanded us to do. It's through the wisdom of the Spirit that we're able to share the gospel at all. It's through the wisdom of the Spirit that we even open our eyes and recognize who this Jesus is. But how many of us say, I want wisdom? In fact, we ought to desire wisdom. In 1 Kings chapter 3, many of us know that wise king Solomon, but not many of us maybe know that he didn't start out that way. 1 Kings chapter 3, we see a story about Solomon. Beginning in verse 5, you can find it on the screen or in your Bible. This is how the story unfolds. In Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, ask what I shall give thee. And Solomon said, thou hast showed unto thy servant David my father great mercy, according as he walked before thee in truth and in righteousness and in uprightness of heart with thee. And thou hast kept for him this great kindness, that thou hast given him a son to sit on the throne, as it is this day. And now, O Lord my God, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David my father. And I am but a little child. I know not how to go out or come in. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, which thou hast chosen, a great people that cannot be numbered nor counted for multitude. Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I might discern between good and bad, for who is able to judge this thy so great a people? And the speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. And God said unto him, because thou hast asked this thing, and hast not asked for thyself long life, neither hast thou asked for riches for thyself, nor hast asked the life of thine enemies, but hast asked for thyself understanding to discern judgment. Behold, I have done according to thy word. Lo, I have given thee a wise and understanding heart, so that there was none like thee before thee, neither after thee shall any arise like unto thee. And I have also given thee that which thou hast not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall be none among the kings like unto thee all thy days. And if thou wilt walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments, as thy father David did walk, then I will lengthen thy days. And Solomon awoke and beheld, it was a dream. And he came to Jerusalem and stood before the ark of the covenant of the Lord and offered up burnt offerings and offered peace offerings and made a feast to all his servants. What's the moral of the story? Solomon had so many different things that he could ask for. Given the choice, given the opportunity, tell me what you want and I'll give it to you. That's what the Lord said to him. And he could have asked for riches. He could have asked for buildings and kingdoms and castles. He could have asked for his enemies to be slain. He could have asked for all his heart's desires. And what does he ask as a little boy? Lord, make me understanding. Make me wise. Make me able to know and discern thy will. Why? Why would he ask for wisdom? Why would he do this? Because like us, Solomon was surrounded, one of those verses told it, by a great multitude of people. The preceding verses show us that Solomon wasn't actually walking the path of his father David. He was offering up idol worship in the high places. He didn't know any better. The world around him was doing it. Why did he ask for wisdom? Because he needed discernment to see what was good and what was bad. He needed the understanding, the wisdom, to be able to navigate through this crazy life. He needed wisdom to know what was good advice and what was bad advice. And because in the same way, he saw that serving God resulted in the greatest blessing. That when he served God in wisdom, not only would he get wisdom, but what else did he get? He would get all of the things which he didn't ask for. God's going to take care of those who serve him. And if we love the Lord and we want to serve him, wisdom should be our aim. And that wisdom is a characteristic that shows itself in good conversation, good living, and most of all, in humility. And this should be our message to the world, a world who is seeking after, maybe not wisdom per se, but knowledge, is seeking after their own truth. We ought to show them that the wisdom that they possess in worldliness does not yield good conduct. If it was true wisdom as wisdom to the Lord, then they would recognize the goodness, the overall goodness, the perfect goodness of our Lord in their actions. And it's with this that we can say, good people alone, don't go to heaven. Because salvation is not by your wisdom and your works and your goodness. No, It is a gift from God and is evidenced by wisdom and works and conversation and godliness. The goodness that comes out of our wisdom and out of our works and of all of these things can only be given by God. And so, we find this type of godly wisdom, but then James turns in the next three verses to a kind of worldly wisdom. Verse 14 says this, "But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth." James goes on to say, if you have this, that is bitter envying and strife, that is not wisdom to be proud of. If you think you're a wise man and you have these two things, you're wrong. And the first term James uses is bitter envying. The Greek word here is zelos, from zeal or zealousness, a word that we even have in our own language, meaning to have zeal, enthusiasm, to have passion. And there is good and bad zeal. There is a time when we have not bitter envying, not bitter zeal, but good zeal. It is good to be zealous for the Lord. It is good to be passionate for the Lord and for the things of the Lord. Well, there's a different type of zeal as well. It's the zeal of zealots, idealists, who would rather a whole nation crumble that they can build up their own than to go about it a different way. Zealous people who would terrorize nations through Islam. Those are a type of zealousness that is not good. You know, yesterday we were at Terry and Roberta's car show and fish fry, and I can't remember who it was, so I'm going to call somebody, you know, I just can't call you by name. Somebody said, man, this is working my envy. I'm out here looking at all these cars. I need one of these cars. And there's one or two ways how that plays out, right? It's good to be zealous and passionate and to see these cars and to say, wow, that's a sweet ride. Maybe if I work real hard one day, I would like to have me a car like that. Well, there's a different kind of zeal, and it's this kind that says, that car right there, it's so nice, I hate the person who owns that. I wish I had something like that. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go and I'm going to put something in his gas tank, make that thing not run no more. I'm going to go and I'm going to unscrew all the bolts to the engine and I'm going to make sure that thing doesn't run like it's supposed to no more. You know what? I'm going to work so hard, not so that I can have something of my own, but so that I can have something better than what he has. It's a very different type of zeal. One is good and one is bad. And James is saying here, the zeal that leads to hatred, the zeal that leads to this emotional envying and strife in our hearts, this is not the zeal that we want. And the sad thing is, y'all, as I read about this bitter envying, this zeal, this is what is occurring in so many churches today. Churches who are serving one community but aren't unified. I'm so thankful for our relationship with Clear Creek and with Grace Chapel and with Greater Morning Star and Antioch and all these different churches in our community that we're unified in the gospel and that we can do things together, because that is not so everywhere. There are churches and communities who are not unified in their serving of God, but they are unified sometimes in their hatred of one another. They compete to see who can be the most successful, who can glory in how much they have. They seek to have bigger and better stuff than the church next door. Not to serve God, no, but to glory in their having more. Let's never become that church. Let's never become the church who is trying to keep up with the church down the road, who is trying to just do stuff for the sake of doing stuff, who is trying to gain stuff for the sake of just having stuff. That's not the purpose. Everything that we should do, it should have one purpose, one unified purpose for all churches, to glorify and to serve God. Instead, we need to be the church that when we visit those other churches, we don't say, oh, I hate this church. I hate how well they're doing. I hate how much good stuff they have. But we need to say, I am so proud that this church is reaching its community. What can we do to be more like them? What can we see them do, their organization, their strategies, their methods, that we can bring back and do the same thing? You know, John Pilate told me a story one time about this revival that was going on down in Florida, and James Taylor and him and a few others loaded up the van, and they went down there, not to glory in and gloat over and hate that church and that revival that was happening, but to see what's going on, what's the Lord doing, and what can we bring back? What will be the purpose for us It's sad that it's in so many churches, but it's not even just in the community of churches. Sometimes it happens within one church's walls, that people would hate others across the pew because they dress better than they do, because they have more authority in the church, or at least that's what they think, than others do. That they have just something to be envious about. That their talents, maybe, that they sing a better solo, that they lead a better Sunday school class, that they, whatever they do, there's envy, there's hatred, there's strife that comes of it. None of these things will give God the glory. Instead, in everything we do, we ought to be striving to glorify and to serve God. And James continues by telling us exactly where that type of wisdom, the envy and the strife, where does that come from? Verse 15 says this, "This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish." It is from this world. It is natural, fleshly. It's even from the devil himself. James wants us to know that the wisdom of verse 13 and the wisdom of verse 14 are pitted against one another. One is from above, and one is from below. One is worldly wisdom, and one is godly wisdom. And each of us in this room, we might say, "I'm verse 13. I'm godly wisdom. I know better than to seek after those things which are fleshly and natural and worldly and devilish." But do we know better? Do we pray like Solomon prayed and said, "Lord, give us wisdom"? Because each and every one of us in this room, we go through hardships in our life. We have questions that we need answers to. We need people whose ear we can talk to and say, "What do I do in this situation?" Who is that person for you? Who is that person you run to for advice? And let's ask some questions about that person. Are they in church? Are they living a godly life? Do they study their Bible? Do they spew filth and hatred from their mouth? Is the person you go to for advice a godly person or an evil person, a devilish person? Oh, I would hate to call your buddy and your friend a devil, an evil person. I'm not saying that. I'm saying he's being used by him, maybe. We need to make sure that the advice we get and the advice we give is from a godly source. Because what's going to happen if we give our ear to someone who is giving us worldly advice, you know what's going to happen? We're going to end up doing worldly stuff. And verse 16 tells us exactly what that does. "For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work." That's what the devil wants. He wants you to buy into worldly wisdom. He wants you to tap into those entertainment that is out there on the TV and in music and in all of the media that is but filth against the Word of God. And he wants you to look to that as your worldly wisdom. He wants that to be the thing that puts you off of track and turns you away from God. He wants that friend who is going to give you advice that is straight from the world to be the advice you run to and you cling to rather than His holy word, rather than the saints in this room who've been there and maybe God saw them through their situation. He wants you to be impacted by those who have worldly wisdom to impart, because that is what will bring about chaos in your church and in your family. And if you want to see what chaos looks like in families, look at our nation today. It is years and years and years of taking worldly wisdom rather than godly wisdom. Because if our families in this nation had been taking godly wisdom all this time, we wouldn't see the divorce rate as it is today. We wouldn't see broken families that are being raised by grandparents and by one family member. We wouldn't be seeing families that are torn apart by alcohol and by drugs. We wouldn't be seeing all of the things that we see today. Families that in front of their children practice sexual immorality and homosexuality. That's the reality today in America. Why? Because the family has bought into confusion and every evil work. Because the devil, at least for right now, in America, has won the battle. He ain't won the war. But right now, he has used worldly wisdom to take us off track. Because here's the thing about worldly wisdom. It looks a whole lot like godly wisdom at first glance. It's real easy to buy into at first glance. It sounds real neat and cool. It sounds like it'd be something worth trying until you see the chaos that it leads to. If you want to see what chaos looks like in the church, it looks like what's occurring in denominations around the world right now. where churches are literally denying the Bible, where they're bowing down to the world, where they're ordaining clergy who do not even closely resemble the characteristics of God's word, but they're homosexuals and transgenders, sometimes wholly atheistic ministers in these churches. This is what chaos looks like when we take worldly advice as the church rather than godly advice. And it seems so simple. So you're just telling us, Brother Taylor, that we should follow this Bible? Yes. I'm saying something you've heard 1,000 times before, but somehow we still let the wisdom of the world overtake us. Be careful the wisdom you have, and be careful of the wisdom you listen to and that you impart to others, because it will have an effect. James finishes out with verses 17 and 18. Verse 17 says this, "But the wisdom that is from above, godly wisdom, is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace." He gives us almost a Pauline list of traits. First, it's pure. There is no wrong in it. It is wisdom that has good intentions. Then, peaceable. It's wisdom that brings about peace in families and churches and in the world. It's wisdom that is gentle. It's not abrasive. It's not harsh, but it comes with the love of God. That wisdom is easy to be entreated. You can ask it anything, any time of the day. That wisdom is full of mercy, forgiveness, loving others, and good fruits. You can see that it's good wisdom. Without partiality, it makes no distinction between anyone. And without hypocrisy, it lives the walk that it talks. That is wisdom that is from above. And when I read a list like that, I have to say, where in the world can I find wisdom like that? Because I look over the pews, and I look through Brooklyn, and I look through our world, and I say, I don't see anybody who matches up to that type of wisdom. That's because the only person who embodies this wisdom is Jesus Christ himself. If you want to see what love and wisdom from above is, and you want to see wisdom that's first pure and then peaceable and gentle and easy to be entreated and full of mercy and good fruits and without partiality and without hypocrisy, look no further than the character of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who had the wisdom to do the most insane rescue plan in all of history, that God above would step down into human flesh, that he would live a perfect life among sinners, that he would say, that criminal's cross that was meant for you and me, I'll climb on it. I'll sacrifice myself. I'll die even though God is not supposed to die. Why? Because he's wise to know that he's powerful over sin and death and hell, and that my God wouldn't stay in the grave, but he would raise up 3 days later, that he would live out a couple more days teaching his disciples on earth, and then he would ascend into heaven with his Father, and let me tell you, he's coming again soon, amen? That's wisdom from above. That's the wisdom that you and I need to look for. And what is James' point then for chapters 2 and 3? Overall point, for 2 chapters he's been telling us, you don't have the wisdom necessary to be saved. You don't have the works necessary to be saved. Your mouth is full of filth. It doesn't have the words necessary to be saved. But thanks be to God and Jesus Christ that he has done all that we need to be saved. Amen. And ever since that salvation, I don't know if it's true for you, but it is true for me, and it's becoming truer and truer every day, that because I have authentic faith in Jesus Christ, first, that faith brought forth works, and then it's going to bring forth good words, and now James is telling us it's going to bring forth good wisdom. These are the character traits that mark the truly changed Christian. Read back through chapters 2 and 3. Are you a Christian? You ought to have good works, good words, and good wisdom. These are the markers of those who follow our God. And so today I wonder, let's ask that question right now. Do you have true faith? Do you have faith that shows good works? Do you have faith that shows good words? And do you, as we study today, have a faith that listens and imparts good, godly wisdom? Because if you don't have those things this morning, James is saying, prove, show me the evidence then that you're a Christian. This is it. This is what the marker of the Christian is. And maybe today, my invitation to you is, you know, Brother Taylor, I think at one time I was on the track to showing these good fruits, to proving and having evidence for my faith, but I've been backslid and I've fallen off of that horse, and I think it's time to get back on. Maybe today you need to come to this altar. You need to do business with God. Maybe you need to tell the church this morning, I've slid back, but I'm ready to start again. Maybe this morning you've been listening to bad wisdom in your life. Maybe it's time to change who your friends are. Maybe it's time to look for wisdom in better places. And maybe today for you, maybe the first time that you've ever recognized that the wisdom that God provides is saving wisdom. It's wisdom that is from above and has the power to break every chain. Maybe today is the day of salvation for you. Whatever your decision is, I'm asking that you would stand with us as we sing this hymn of invitation, The Room at the Cross.
Thank you for joining us online today. Remember, you can find additional videos at these online locations. If you would like to give, you can mail your offering to First Baptist Church Brooklyn at P.O. Box 340 in Brooklyn, Mississippi 39425. If you would like to talk to someone, you can call our church number or you can visit us for one of our in-person worship times. We hope to see you soon.